We are on Points in Manhattan, Kansas. We are more specifically at Tallgrass Tap House. It's Grant Flanders. It's Matt Hall. It's Natalie Hall, Mike Free, the way she should be. On the KSO show, not a KSO today. This is a full-length KSO show. Flando, man, we got back from St. Louis maybe a couple hours ago. You got a little nap in, which I think you deserved.
It felt good.
Now we're here at Tallgrass, ready to talk probably what we saw in St. Louis, right?
Yeah. What a trip. What a fun trip.
It was a really good time.
Cool little house we had. I mean, I know we had a Pac-Man thing inside. That was our house. It had everything in it for us. Three different bedrooms.
It was just one bathroom, but it was enough, especially if a guy were to use his bucket up in the attic
to do various things with.
Right. Yep. Nat looked at it and said, what? So I will say, hopefully our Airbnb owners are not listening. Flando may have gone pee in his bucket upstairs in his attic. And he came down the next morning and he says to me, Matt, I might have done this. You might have done it or you did do it.
Oh, yeah. I emptied it.
After we emptied it.
After he made sure I did, he was like, it's probably going to start smelling.
I did. I said, your attic is going to start smelling.
It's better than what I thought of an alternative for some reason. Yeah. At one point, I thought of, there's a big pot downstairs. I didn't use that.
You could have just came down. You could have just went to the bathroom.
I could have just came down and went to the bathroom.
Right.
But those stairs are scary and creepy very small.
He's not lying. He'd be listening. Again, we loved this place. We're not talking trash. But yeah, the steps were maybe like 6 inches long. Yep. Maybe half your foot could fit on there. And you did. You soaped it out. You cleaned it out. It didn't have a liner. It was just a plastic can. Yep. It was probably made for that.
Yeah.
So if you're still with us on the KSO show beyond that
intro, didn't say trash on the side. It said pee.
Trash.
Oh, I'm kidding. Anyway.
Oh, my gosh. Okay.
Yep.
So what we're going to tell you about now, though, is actually our experiences. Back-to-back nights, Wednesday and Thursday in St. Louis, outside of St. Louis, a couple different places. Seeing both Luke Kasubke and Davion Bradford. Wednesday night, Flando, we went and saw Luke Kasubke at, I believe it was Althoff
High School.
Catholic, right?
A Catholic in Bellevue, Illinois.
Right. So we crossed
Belleville, Illinois.
We crossed the state line. We saw Chaminade really put it on them. But before, we're going to talk about, the point of this is to talk to people about what you saw in Luke and Davion. But for people who don't get to go in these things and that kind of stuff, what was that gym like? What was it like for you going? This was your first time you could have gone and watch kids like this in person. What was the gym like? What was the game like? Just share your experience a little bit, then we'll talk about Luke more specifically.
Not going to lie, I expected a Catholic high school in 2020 to be decked out super nice, because after years and years of getting tons of money from kids, parents, to go there.
This is all our assumptions. We don't know this.
But I went to a Catholic school, so I can say, it costs money.
Right.
It was pretty average, it was probably below average gym, in high school.
It was pretty meh.
It was pretty meh.
Let's be honest. Yeah.
Especially because I thought maybe it ended up being nicer than Melville High School, but Melville High School was
very
actually
nice.
Pretty nice. The gym was really cool looking. Experience inside there was kind of a small town Catholic school gym. And Luke went in there. It was funny. Coach Lowry talked with him on the ride home, and he told me how Althoff High School is usually really good.
Right.
Now is obviously down years for them, and Luke put on a show for him yesterday.
He sure did. I'll spoil the stats, then you can talk more about it. We have him, I believe, 28 points. We had him 6 of 8 from 3. I had him making 5 straight at one point. I think he's 11 of 16 from the floor.
Yep.
That 28 came in only 3 quarters. He didn't play a second and a fourth like you noted. So, guy who'd been battling the flu this year, I believe, illness, injury, that kind of stuff, had maybe his second best game of the year in front of us. But about outside the stats, just tell me on a pause, I'll ask you for negatives later. What are things you liked that you saw from Luke Kasubke that you think will eventually perhaps translate to K-State in the Big 12
level? Yeah, I mean, instantly his offense is going to be key. His shooting is going to be key. Yeah. K-State struggled to shoot the ball. I mean, the few good shooters on the team, Mike McGurl, a few others, they're not elite. K-State hasn't had an elite shooter in a long time. I mean, Cam Stokes is probably the closest thing to it.
Watch your mouth. Go ahead. Yeah.
And Luke Kasubke and even Nigel Pack are pure shooters coming into the class. And Luke's probably the best out of all of them. He's got a quick release from anywhere, from pull-up, from catch and shoot, three-point. He loves the mid-range as well, but he was key to putting up threes in this one. It was an easy 28 points for him. He made it look super easy. Struggled at first, but obviously
missed
the first couple shots. But like you said, great percentage. So obviously the rest of the game, he was really, really good. And yeah, he was a reason why they blew the team out. They probably would have blew him out anyway, but because it's a good program in Chaminade, but Luke was obviously the best player on that team that night.
You nailed it, but I want to follow up on it. That's something that I thought was encouraging. You talked about with Luke shooting the ball. is we saw all sorts of makes.
Yep.
You know, we saw a couple of dunks, of course. He's a good vertical athlete. We saw, like you talked about, we saw mid-range jumpers, yep. 17, 19 feet or so off the pull-up. And you mentioned it, too. I mean, we saw at least one three that was probably 24, 25 feet out that he just took, you know, without concern in the world yep. and nailed it. He hit threes on the break.
Uh-huh.
He hit threes that were part of the offense. He did a great job, I know, one time of yep. getting a guy open, running to the corner, getting it back and hitting a three.
Yep.
So I'm just repeating what you said, but I thought that was encouraging. He wasn't just a catch-and-shoot guy.
Nope.
He hit threes from all sorts
nope.
of different places.
Nope, and he has an underrated handle, I think, from what people – I mean – yeah, he's able to go around the back, do a lot of different things with his handle and get into the lane and do a lot of good things, find teammates like you said. And eventually, yeah, it flowed back to him. The offense did, and he knocked down shots with that quick release. It's pretty simple for Luke to get his shot off.
Now, on the flip side, I don't think we saw a lot negative with either kid, if we're being
yep.
totally honest.
Yep.
But it's not all perfect. And both, we'll get into this maybe at the end, both are not these – they're both very good prospects.
Yep.
Neither we're expecting to come in and start next
nope.
year, play 20 minutes next year. So that's not what we're – when we're describing their mm-hmm. strengths and weaknesses, we're not saying these guys are going to – next year they're coming in and playing 20 minutes. But you said to me, and I don't disagree with you, we talked about it some, but defensively we didn't see a ton from Luke on Wednesday night.
Absolutely. And I think part of the reason is, you know, he knew I was coming. He knew we were coming
right.
to film
yep.
him do highlights, you know. Highlights means offense. So I think there was a focus of
their
offense for
yep.
him that night. Coach knew, everyone knew. So it might be a regular thing for them this year to say, hey, we got great defenders around you. We want you to be the scorer, because you did see him a little lazy on defense sometimes,
yeah.
trying to cheat, trying to get to, you know, double a guy and leave his guy open, allowing for easy baskets on
yep.
the other end.
Yep.
But he also showed keen ability to jump passing lanes at times because of that as well, and he got a few steals that led to dunks and stuff like that. But I think his focus was to be aggressive offensively, and also be aggressive defensively so he could get easy buckets
right.
to show off for KSO.
Absolutely. I mean, he told you as much, you know, afterwards. And, yeah, now if you were there with us, Chaminade pressed virtually the
yep.
entire game.
Yep.
And they kind of hid Luke in the back, you know, even though he's a guard for them.
Yep.
And he really was, like Flanders said, gambling for steals, that kind of stuff. And if you wanted to be very critical and just watch his defense, you would say he wasn't very good defensively.
Yep.
But what Flando just said, him and I kind of talked about on the baseline during the game, like, it's pretty clear – you know, his role is to go out and score for those guys. It's not.
Nope.
We don't think he's incapable of defending by any stretch, because he's got good length. He's probably 6'4 and a half, 6'5. He has, you know, long arms. He has a good lower body.
Yep.
He has a better frame you expect. I think the other thing I'd throw in, if I were going to be honest and
yep.
critical, people want to compare, and rightfully so, I'm not criticizing. Christian Brown is a natural comparison.
Mm-hmm.
The freshman at Kansas, similar rivals ranking, similar size, shooters, a lot of similarities. I think Christian Brown, for me, is a little bit better of an athlete. I think Luke vertically is a pretty good athlete. I don't think he has a ton of speed or quickness.
Yep.
Again,
exactly.
We're trying to be honest. We're not trying to knock a kid. He's a three. You know, he's a Rivals
yep.
150. He's a
yep.
good recruit. But we're not really doing you much of a service if we just sit down and tell you, hey, he's the greatest player ever. Hit a bunch of shots. There's nothing wrong with him, because he wasn't perfect.
He's a 6'4 Dean Wade, right?
Is that I will say, I think I might have said on the KSO
yeah.
today, yesterday, but his offensive game, and I said this to Flanders, this is half a huge compliment, half not a compliment. Like, here's offensive game reminds me a lot of Dean Wade.
Yep.
And Dean Wade was a great offensive player.
Mm-hmm.
Part of what made Dean so good, we talked about, was that he was 6'10".
Yep.
Luke Kasubke's 6'4", 6'5".
Yep.
So some of the shots Dean could get off because of his height, Luke Kasubke
exactly.
doesn't get. But he still has great size
yep.
for his position as a two-guard.
Yep, so, and great handle and ability to play make and get open shots.
I think the handle and the playmaking
yep.
is what surprised me. He's
yep.
not a point guard. Nobody
nope.
started thinking that. He is not. But he has a plus handle
yep.
for a two-guard wing-type player.
Absolutely. That's going to come in handy for K-State. And as far as, I was going to say this too, I wrote that he'd played through illness and injury at every
yeah.
game. Coach Lowry did tell me he has missed some games because of that. That
yeah.
was key.
Yeah.
And yeah, it was the first time he'd really felt back to himself, I mean, since all year.
And
I mean,
they rode him. He didn't
yep.
he didn't sit a second in the first three quarters.
Exactly,
yeah.
yeah. So it's good to see, and that's why I think, yeah, they're going to go down this stretch, going to playoffs, knowing this has got to be our guy to score the basketball so we can win games. Everyone else, do your job elsewhere. He's going to be the key focus, and he's getting healthy at the right time for Chaminade.
I want to move on, of course, to the trip to Melville and to seeing Davion Bradford, but we do need to take the time to talk about Terrace Reed,
yeah.
right?
Yes, we do.
2022 junior, or 2022 recruit, means as a sophomore
yep.
right now. You were very prepared to see this
yep.
kid. 6'8", 6'7", I'm not sure. You know, he's listed at 6'8".
Yep.
He could weigh 275 pounds.
Uh-huh.
That wouldn't surprise me. He has a monster lower body.
Yep.
Just early. And again, this is a four-star kid for 2022. They're very young. It's early in the process. But your thoughts on Terrace Reed?
He was giant. I mean, like,
yeah.
biggest kid in the gym.
KSU freak
eight.
On the board.
Yep.
I'm sorry to cut you off.
Yeah,
I do
no,
it all the time.
Yep.
But if you're looking at body type, And he said the same thing. This is not who he is. But look at Zion Williamson.
Yeah.
See yourself a 6'7", 6'8", just muscular, beefy guy. That's what he looked like. He wasn't Zion Williamson, as Freak also said.
I mean, maybe this is a bad comparison. I think he's got a little more athleticism than this guy, but Zach Randolph and all, good footwork, lower, big body, and not like the tallest guy in the world, but can play center, you know. And I think Terrace Reed has a lot of he's only a sophomore. Everyone kept telling us this. He's just scratching the surface of what he can do. I mean, it's exciting to think about what Terrace Reed can do since K-State's been so in on him early.
Yep.
It's K-State, Nebraska, the only two high majors to go after him this early. And his footwork's good for a sophomore. He's got a decent jump shot we didn't really see in the game. They did focus on Luke. In pregame we did. They did focus on Luke during the game, and Terrace, he seems to be a team player. Yeah. He did grab a few offensive rebounds that Luke actually missed early on and laid him right back in. And he's a big body that I think is going to get better and better. It's going to be a tough get for K-State because four-star already, 75, I think, and Rivals 150 for 2022. And he's going to be a kid that is going to get a lot of offers in the next couple of years.
Absolutely. So the next night, well said, Flannan, we went to Melville. Which was, do you know where? What town were we in? We were in.
Is it Melville? Is it not Melville?
I mean, we were in St. Louis outside. I don't know. We were on the Missouri side, I think, right?
Yeah,
it doesn't really matter. No one cares. I mean, let's be honest, though. But hey, the same thing. Like, this was a school we went to not knowing. Like, public school, St. Louis, we know it's going to be like, it was pretty gosh darn nice.
It was really nice.
It was a. Now, this was his home court as opposed to Luke playing on the road.
Exactly.
But a much better atmosphere.
It was. And we should say, I think Chaminade would be a cool place to go to a home game. Really beautiful facilities.
That nice
unit
Chaminade did on the road. They look nice. Yeah.
Great program. As far as Melville, I was surprised. I didn't expect those windows made it look
like a field house
classier. But like big windows with the black around them, and
it
just looked really good. Yeah, because we got there before it got dark, so we get to see that coming through, and the JV game playing and stuff, and then we spotted Davion and we got excited. You know, 7-footer walking around. You know. K-State has this guy coming in next year.
Right.
So, and then he played amazingly.
No doubt about it. A funny note, we'll get into Davion, is we got there early enough both nights to watch the entire JV games of both. And they were fun to watch.
Yeah, they were.
But both games were such blowouts. The fourth quarter of the varsity games turned into a rematch, of the JV games from earlier in the night. We got to see kids change numbers on the varsity and light it up again, But let's talk about Davion. You know, stats-wise, I believe 17 points. I think he was 8 of 10 from the floor. 1-1 from the foul line, that would be 17 points, correct? We were told we weren't there, but I think his last game, perhaps, he was 8-9 from the foul line.
9 of 10?
9 of 10. So the free throw shooting is getting better for him, over 90% the last couple of games. 6 dunks, 7 blocks. I thought he started a little slow.
Yeah.
Same thing, knew we were there.
Yep.
Like, it was very obvious, but then beyond that, he was absolutely dominant.
You're right, he did start a little slow. I mean, he didn't really pick up till about...
And they were triple-teaming him on every touch for a little while, yeah.
But about 4 minutes into the game, which means... 4 minutes left in the first quarter.
Right.
That's when he really started to turn it on. And I mean, I think he had 15 of his 17 points in that first half.
At least 13 of them. At least.
And barely played in the third quarter, second half. And put up 17 points total, like you said. Around 7 blocks, so defensively.
Well, at least we know of seven. We saw seven.
Yep.
We didn't always have our head up. It was
exactly.
at least seven.
Yep.
Yeah.
So, I mean, just a dominant force, yes. Both Chaminade and Melville didn't play great competition, but saw
the end of the first quarter. I think it was 32-7.
Oh my god!
But I didn't think. Was it Summit?
It was Summit.
I didn't think they looked. I know people watch those videos and they see a couple clips where there's a 5'6" kid guarding.
Yep.
You know, but for most of the game, and these aren't D1 players. They had 6'5" and 6'6" defenders guarding him, who were relative. I thought looking at their bodies, I thought this might be an okay game, and it was not.
It was not.
Melville had other guys too.
Yep.
I mean, who
they
were
did.
Men.
Yep.
Yeah.
And they moved the ball around really well. Davion included moved the ball around.
Yep.
Get this one really great pass to a cutter in the lane
you
for a dunk.
Say, oh, nice pass.
Oh, my God. I know.
On video.
Yeah, go watch the highlight video. Hear my voice. I think I might start commentating every time.
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. But, he really did everything you wanted him to do in that game because he's not outside. He's really just a paint presence on both ends right now.
Yep.
Not a broken shot by any means. Like you said, he hit free throws last game. He has one free throw in this one, and we watched it in warm-ups. Probably junior year, K-State Davion Bradford might be able to step out 15 feet and make you respect that.
That he knows.
Exactly.
You guys were talking. Go watch the video with Flannan and Davion Bradford. They were both good. I'm not valuing one over the other, but I think you and Davion talked longer.
Yep.
And it was kind of a fun, like, out-of-the-way setting just by lockers to where he really – both shared a lot.
Yep.
If you are listening to this and you haven't watched Flanders' interview on our YouTube page or on K-State Online with Luke Kasubke and Davion Bradford, take 10 minutes to do it, you know. It's cool to hear these kids talk and learn about their relationship, their thoughts. But, yeah, I'm getting off track.
Yeah,
it's something you guys talked about. And I think you're right. I think in a couple of years, 2-3 years, mm-hmm. he might be a guy if you leave him for 15.
Yep.
You know, I don't want to knock Levi Stockard by saying this because we both respect Levi Stockard. I think
absolutely.
He's a good kid and plays hard. So I don't mean this disrespectfully, but I think you could hope maybe rich man's Levi Stockard. You know, a guy, Levi could step out to 15, 18, but he doesn't have the size, the bulk, the length, all those things that Davion Bradford has.
Yeah, absolutely. And right now what Davion's doing is exactly what you want him to do and see him do. He's dominating a smaller competition in the paint. And, yeah, his first bucket, he moved guys out of the way and he laid it in.
Yeah.
The next five buckets were dunks.
Right.
And it's just that's what's exciting, too, is, I mean, K-State hasn't had a guy that's that aggressive at dunking the basketball every time he's near the rim with that kind of size and that kind of aggression. And that's what most excites me about him at that end. And I think you could say from that game he's not a great rebounder, but I think we said it, not many balls. Balls bounced far away from him. I don't expect him to be an amazing rebounder. He's not that athletic. He's not super unathletic,
right.
But he's kind of a tweener as far as that goes. But I think he's got the ability. He's got the size to do it. And I think both ends of the floor, he can help K-State. I don't know about instantly freshman year, but later on in his career for sure.
You've already really nailed it. I was going to ask for like strengths, weaknesses. You've already kind of covered them. A couple of things I'll just push you on for further because you did a great job of asking him about him. He admitted to you. You literally asked him in that video, like, hey, you know, blocking shots, is that something you've kind of grown into?
Yep.
And he said for you, yeah, man, I'm not lying. I didn't know how to, like, until this year. So you just see seven-footers and they block everything.
Absolutely.
Something that wasn't a natural skill of his. And then rebounding, I agree with you.
Mm-hmm.
You would expect, you go watch a 7-foot, 260-pound kid in high school, he's going to gobble up 15 boards.
Yep.
He didn't. He probably had 5 or 6. So on one hand, I'd be a little critical of his rebound. On the other hand, I'm with you. I don't know that I counted one that went by him. He did.
Absolutely.
His teammate, every shot they took, there weren't a lot of chances. He has a tip dunk you can see in your highlight packages. So, again, same thing. We're not trying to tell you he's the greatest prospect in the world because if I were being critical, I'd say what you said. He's not a great athlete. He's an okay athlete for seven-footer. If he was a great athlete, he'd be a five-star top 10 kid. Right.
Yep.
So, I mean, he's a good athlete. His body, I see different things about. I'm encouraged by his body. He has some lean muscle mass in his upper body, which I think his body looks good. He has some bad weight on him. Sure he does. And he will have work to do. It might be 3 years till his body is done. But, I mean, and again, I hate doing this because it's not fun to knock kids. But people are going to compare him to James Love because James Love's a near seven-footer. Davion Bradford's body looks different right now as a high school senior than James Love has at
absolutely K-State. And obviously more productive too in high school because James Love wasn't even scratching the 150.
Right.
Davion Bradford's a Rivals 150 7-footer 4-star guy.
Right.
Yeah.
The recruiting rankings aren't perfect.
No, they're not.
But if we're gonna talk about him, we should talk about him.
And James Love, Nigel Shad, they didn't scratch the 150. So I do think Davion's got a little something different than both those guys have.
Right. The one I think somebody on Twitter asked me, like, who do you compare him to? You know I love Kevin Samuel at TCU. So, I mean, that's an extreme compliment.
Yep.
And two, he's got a long ways to go to get there.
Yep.
So, when I compare the two, I'm not saying, in fact, I'm not predicting, for the record, that Davion Bradford's going to be as good as Kevin Samuel because I think Kevin Samuel's a great player and will only get better at TCU. That said, it's not crazy to compare the two. We looked at as recruiting profiles, very similar. You know, as far as national ranking, 4-star ranking, who offered him, how big they are. It's not crazy to have some hope he could be like Kevin Samuel. Because I think Kevin Samuel outperformed his ranking. And if Davion Bradford does too, it's not crazy to think he could be a player like
absolutely.
That.
I see him being a Derek Culver. No, I'm just kidding. Derek Culver is a whole different kind of prospect.
Right.
But yeah, Samuel to me is like the perfect comparison now for what Davion Bradford ceiling could be. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, Kevin Samuel, not a shooter, not a great athlete. He's a nice athlete, but he's just about, you know, length, aggressiveness. He finishes great on there. But he has great hands.
Great feet.
You hope Davion, you know, can develop those things. The other game that we were at, there were other good basketball players for sure, but nobody, at least at the moment, that we need to discuss that's a K-State target at all.
Nope. I mean, there really isn't anyone.
Meaning Melville, yeah.
Yeah, not Melville. Yeah, that's the thing. We did see, one guy that has a great issue. He's going to JUCO route.
Yep.
Lowry and K-State are completely aware of him.
Right.
And
if you watch the clips of Flando's the kid who throws down the monster dunk on Davion's really nice pass.
Exactly.
K-State's aware of him. He's a really good player. He didn't have the grades to go D1.
He's going
to
go JUCO, so it could be someone we're discussing here a couple years from now.
35, number 35.
That's right.
Remember that, yeah.
So, yeah.
Probably, I don't know his name.
Yeah,
he's got. But he's probably a 6'6", 6'7", wing. He was very athletic.
Exactly.
He looked like a D1 player.
Kevin Durant. No,
you have great comparisons. Let's move past the recruiting for a little bit, you know, and talk about, you know, just what's going to happen, I think, tomorrow, real briefly. We have Texas, K-State tomorrow. It's funny, like, you were, you know, it's okay to say, you know, coffee with Chris happens sometimes, so it's okay. Kurtz is here. So so you say hi.
Kurtz?
So, like, it is okay to say, you know, I talked to my home and that kind of stuff. I lost my train of thought, Flando. Oh, yeah. Anyway, you asked Lowry. We're in the front seat. You asked Lowry, hey, what's going on this weekend?
He's
like, well, we play Texas tomorrow. Like, you were just making conversation. And he said that. But Texas tomorrow, of course. We have beat, you know, everyone, you know, us included, has beat the K-State's losing and Cartier-Jada situation. Like I said, we talked about it on KSO today. Me and DY did. So if you want to hear that again, go back and listen again. Flano and I don't really have to go over it again. The Texas game, though, it is one of these games where it's a team that at home I think you need to be competitive with. I'm not going to say you need to beat them because, you know, it's not going to change the outlook of your season. But I think it's a game where K-State needs to be competitive. And gosh dang it, it wouldn't be bad if they beat the Longhorns at home.
And, you know, it's the first time I have a gut feeling that they might win. Yeah. They've been on a streak of losses.
Right.
So just go with my prediction. No, I'm just kidding. But I think you're right. Texas hasn't made great this year. You're at home against a team that you should be able to be competitive with. You should be able to beat. But, yeah, don't expect it. We see K-State, the way they played this year, and, I mean, it's not guaranteed. But, yes, like you said, you want to be competitive.
A guy I want to bring up because he's one of your guys. You know who I'm going to bring up here. We kept yelling in at DY because we were in St. Louis the night of the Texas Tech game.
Uh-huh.
We weren't at the game, of course.
AG.
We would just yell at DY every so often. It's the Antonio Gordon
AG.
Game. But a big game for Antonio Gordon. I mean, 16, 17 points. I think he's 6-7 from the field, 8 boards. A guy who we had talked about a lot, you know, off the air as I was a little concerned about from his struggling. He was very good against Texas Tech.
I think the most promising thing from that was when he started to fire up. Like, it was near the end of the game, like, which shows he's not afraid. Like, he has the ability.
Like
he's not afraid to take the shot near the end of the game. He cut it within 5 after hitting 2 back-to-back threes and gave K-State a shot. Had, you know, Cardi dunked the ball and it could have been a whole another game. But AG kind of sparked a run for K-State and could show, I mean, that kind of game, for a freshman to have that could be a confidence booster going into, you know, next season.
Right, you got to hope so. Yeah. So, of course, K-State, Texas, Saturday, Manhattan. We'll have full coverage of it on KSO. We'll do all this stuff. We'll do the photos. We'll do the highlights. We'll do the post game. We'll do the story. We'll do Flanders thoughts. We'll do all sorts of things.
Do they got to go AG like a lot more now just to get them really prepared for?
I think he's earned. I think I'd say yes in the short term.
He
played really well. And if he comes out against Texas tomorrow and he gets good minutes and plays high energy, give him 25 minutes.
Yeah.
I don't care. It's awesome. He's earned it. But he's got to keep playing hard.
That's
he's got to keep playing well. Playing hard has never been the question.
Yeah, no doubt. His rebound is great.
Let's be honest. At some point, the guy has to make a shot.
Exactly.
You know, I mean,
he finally showed something.
Right. Chris Nelson teaches all the time that Monty and Antonio are going to be open for corner threes every possession.
Yep.
They've got to make some of them.
Yep.
And not the only two, Xavier. I mean, we're not going down the path of picking on players or whatever. But he needs to make some shots. He made a lot of shots against Tech. Hopefully, he keeps doing
it. I'm excited to see it.
Man, Kurtz is here. Nats is
Should we ask Kurtz a question?
I don't think so. Yeah, no. Pass it over. Pass it over to him.
I don't really know things.
Let's think of two. Just completely. Go actually be unprepared for right now.
Okay.
So
yeah.
You said you almost got run over here. What happened when you walked in this place?
Well, I was literally walking up to the table
and
this lady was like going really fast and then her friend said something to her and she stopped and turned around like directly in me. Like I was like face to face.
Do you think second question, do you think this was on purpose? Do you think they saw you coming from a long ways away and they kinda like, hey, that guy, I kinda wanna bump into him? You know what I mean? And they gradually set this in motion from the moment you walked in.
I hadn't considered that, but my question would be, what's the end game? Like, are they trying to do it, like, as a mean thing, or are they trying to do it as, like,
no, like, I'd rather, hey, that guy, I mean, I'm trying to pick my wording a little bit here. So I'm saying, it's like, hey, that guy looks cool. I would like to bump up against him. And And I think that's all maybe it was.
I mean, if I had a dime for every time someone said that to me.
You know, I mean, did I say that appropriately? You think I got that in? So why we have you, though, because I think there's probably as good of a voice as anybody on it. I have followed on the Twitter. I think you said K-State baseball has won three straight with Missouri.
Yeah.
And
hey,
the pitching's been a little bit good. I know game one they struggled at the plate, but it sounds like they've been good since then overall. The Cats?
Yes.
The Cats?
Very
Nats
good.
Nats is very interested in this,
very
too.
Very good. Yeah, so the starting pitching is way, way, way better. Way better than where it's been.
Yeah.
Basically, the guy they're starting on Sundays now was the Big 12 Freshman of the Year last year. They have a top 100 prospect that's the Friday night guy. And the other guy's been the best, and he's the one that threw today. Connor McCauley struck out 8. He's been like 12 innings, 2
runs
so far.
Right?
Yeah, Missouri's a pretty good team. Like that's,
they ran
that's
away
a pretty
from
good
the
program.
Cats of the SEC. They couldn't run today.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, they probably should have won 3 of 4 in that first series, but UTRGV won the WAC. They're not terrible.
Yeah.
So I'm very encouraged.
Baseball is like super casual, isn't even the right word. I'm not going to lie. I don't pay, beside what Kurt says, I don't pay enough attention to baseball. But baseball is funny because you see names like that, and you're like, oh, they must be. So, you know, like in basketball, you see, you know, one of these 8-word name schools, and you're like, they're terrible. In baseball, they might be a good program.
Yep.
You know, I mean, yeah.
Let me ask you this, because I kept debating this over the weekend when I was in Edinburgh, Texas, by the way, like damn near Mexico.
Yeah.
So you see UTRGV, right?
Uh-huh.
UTRGV.
Is that the same? Did they play Oklahoma in basketball this year or something like that?
Maybe so. They used to be Pan American, which is where Lon Cruger coached, right?
That's a better name. I know who
that is. Well, so when you see UTRGV, how would you pronounce it if you just, like, said it as a word? How would you? That's what we were debating.
UTRGV. No, I'm not going to say it. I mean, like, I think I would say utter.
See, I was saying like you. I was saying like Uterg.
Right.
Uterg.
UTRVG. Is that what we're saying?
RGV.
UTRGV. UTRGV. Well, I mean, the problem is there's no other vowel, so like the U's got to be
tough.
A sound instead of U. I don't know. But I think I know who that is because I'm pretty sure when we were sitting in the press conference at the Liberty Bowl, they had an Oklahoma game on to our left, and I think they were playing UTRGV. I was like, who the heck is Oklahoma playing right now? But they have a baseball program, too.
Yeah.
So there you
who
go.
Who knew?
You said you were near the border. Did you see Greg Robinson?
So we're going to take the mic back here in a second. Flanders hollers at Kurtz. You said you were near the border. Did you see Greg Robinson? Who was pulled over, I believe.
That's the guy that had, like, pounds and pounds and pounds of weed, right?
157 pounds of marijuana.
Whoa.
Which Nats did the math. She said it may have been $500,000 worth of marijuana.
Damn.
And I think it was DY who showed me, like, a tweet that said this, like, the Browns will not be bringing back Greg Robinson. Well, no, they're not. I mean, like, it's not an option probably at this point.
Oh, my God.
You know?
I mean, they're talking about the CBA. They may loosen the restrictions on marijuana, so maybe they'll let him back.
And, hey, he was just ahead of the curve. You know? I mean, that's
exactly.
All it was.
Exactly.
Are you excited to watch the Cats in Texas tomorrow?
No, I mean, I think it's a game that arguably they should win, actually, right?
Yeah,
I mean,
saying, I think.
I was talking to Craig Way earlier today. He was the play-by-play voice of Texas, and he certainly did not talk like somebody that expects Texas to win.
Yeah.
Like 4 of their 5 starters from that first game aren't healthy right now. Like, Jericho Sims being gone inside, like, really, really hurts them.
Yeah.
And Texas, they had been wretched before that game against TCU where they had Matt Baker just kind of randomly go off for 20 points. And even another thing, Craig Way was kind of like, I don't know where that came from. So I think it's a game K-State should win. It's going to be on CBS. That's kind of cool.
Oh, yeah. The ratings through the roof, too, probably.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Well, CBS might be happy that they have that K-State-KU game now.
Yeah.
Next week. That's got some intrigue to it.
Some intrigue to it.
Texas game.
As the Cats get red hot going
into it.
Really
intriguing. Yeah, hey.
You know?
That's right. I hope that the story will be the game because I've been talking about this week. That, like, there's been so much drama this year. Like, it's like you can't go two K-State games without some crazy, like, drama, whether it's Fran Fraschilla or the fight in Lawrence or Cardi yelling at Bruce. It's just like, can we just have, like, a drama-free Final Five games? That would be lovely.
You know, just some
I'm just here for the basketball,
Yeah,
okay?
We're not. Nats, when we started talking about this, she's like, did you see the picture of Noah being in the Texas game? And I had not seen it. I did see some tweets at us when we were at Altop Catholic, that said there's more people there than at Texas. And I was like, okay.
Yeah.
And now looking at this,
That's 10 minutes before tip-off.
Is that the guy he just talked to? Who did you talk to today?
I don't think Craig Way.
That's a totally different name. Not even similar.
that's some guy that covers the team, and that was 10 minutes before tip-off.
10 minutes to tip-off. Yeah. I mean, this is old news. You guys have probably seen it.
Is there
90 people?
100? Like 100 people there?
I know there's 100 people in the Irwin Center, which holds, I think, like 16-3 or 18-6.
It's giant.
Like that.
That's the other thing that's funny about it.
And like, there is nobody in there. And, man, yeah. I tell you what, that is something else. Well, man, Chris, I know you just got here, but you should eat with us. We're all going to order food now. We're going to eat and that kind of stuff.
Is Texas going to fire Shaka? Give me a hot take.
That was the talk after the video.
I guess I will say this. I don't know how they don't. I mean, like, and I don't, like you, I mean, I don't have any beef with Shaka Smart. I think he seems like a nice guy. I have no ill will towards him. I don't want him to lose his job and all that kind of stuff. That said, like, I mean, how long has he been there now? Is it like
5 years?
Yeah, I mean, and they're just not a good basketball program. No. They're not showing signs of life. You know, I mean, in those 5 years they've had, I'll forget names, but, you know, Mo Bamba and Jackson Hayes
Brooklyn, Jared Allen?
Jared Allen, yeah. I mean, like, they've had high-level NBA talent, you know, and they haven't won with it. They haven't won with experienced guys. They haven't won with talent guys. And Shaka Smart's one of those guys, and I know KSU fan, if he was here, I'll say it for him. I would have bet you whatever you wanted that he'd be successful at Texas.
Yeah.
Scott Frost in Nebraska. Like, I would have said, these guys are going to be successful there, and he just isn't. And he's got to be, right? I mean, like, and I think it's very likely.
They're actually talking about – I was reading the Austin American-Statesman today. They're talking about John Beilein.
Man.
Beilein being the guy at Texas.
Well, he's proving he's a good, you know, college coach. You know, I mean, you know, relating to athletes. We'll get past that. You know, yeah. I mean, that kind
By
of
the
stuff.
Way, yeah. has anyone ever seen – have we seen Fan in the same room as Shaka? Has
never
he been
have,
at a Texas
never
camp
have.
Yet?
No, never have one. They look alike. Two, Fan, I hope you're listening because he's just the biggest apologist ever for Shaka Smart. You know, I mean, like,
I wonder
man,
why.
He's to Shaka Smart what I am to Bruce Weber. I'm just kidding. He's actually very fair in his analysis of Shaka Smart. But no, I have not seen them together. Although last week, I think it was, Fan showed us some pictures of Fan as a young man, like 1994,
Ooh.
Like, and he looked good.
Sexy young man.
I'm glad you're not on a mic. I hope Vayners is not picking up on your mic. I mean,
say it again.
He was a sexy young man.
Yeah. Well, he was. I mean, it is what it is. So, yeah.
Squeaky face.
Okay. It's broken down. I appreciate Kurtz for coming on. You should stay here and have some dinner with us.
Yes.
Nat's going to eat with us. Flanders, you can take your dinner and walk back to your apartment. Appreciate your time. We're all going to be at the game tomorrow. We'll all talk about K-State basketball after they hammer the Texas Longhorns on CBS,
hammer.
On national TV. Put it on your antenna. You don't even need cable for it. You don't need ESPN Plus.
Put
you don't need
bunny
YouTube
ears.
TV. You put bunny ears on, like Kurt said, and watch the Cats just drill the Longhorns. That's it. Tell your friends bye.